Hi, and welcome to another session of the Microsoft Virtual Academy. In this session, we're going to take a look at some software development fundamentals. This will actually focus on some preparation for our MTA, Microsoft Technology Associate Certification Exam 98-361, and we'll cover some core fundamentals that you'll need to understand as you get started in software programming. So let's go ahead and introduce who your presenters are today. My name is Jerry O'Brien, and I'm a technical content development manager here at Microsoft. I've been focusing on the developer and the SQL Server platforms for some time. I'm also a content author. And a little over 18 years of experience, 8.5 of that here at Microsoft. And I'm a Microsoft certified trainer, been a software developer and a consultant in the industry, written numerous books on IT topics, and actually written a few courses as well. Currently program in Visual Basic, C#, Java, and Objective-C. And the most important part I like to have at the last is I'm a lifelong learner. So like you, I enjoy learning about technology. That's kind of where I'm at today. I continuously learn on a daily basis. So now I'll let Paul introduce himself.
Hi, my name is Paul Pardee, and I'm a content development lead at Microsoft. I've been in the software industry for about 20 years and doing programming most of that time. And I started out programming in Visual Basic and moved to scripting, and then I moved into object-oriented languages like C# and spent most of my time in that language. I've also programmed against SQL Server, so that gives me some experience with databases as well. I co-authored a book on Microsoft Access many years ago, and recently published an app to the Windows 8 App Store called Movie Notes, which I'm very proud of.
Great. Thanks, Paul. And welcome. Glad to have you here on my team as we present this MVA. So a quick overview of what we'll cover today. In our software development fundamentals, we've got about 7 modules to go through. So over the next few hours, we'll take a look at some general software development. This is where we'll focus on some of the non-coding aspects of what a software developer might have to do on a day-to-day basis. We'll take a look at the application lifecycle management and a little bit of a discussion on how you might evaluate technical specifications. Then we'll start getting into kind of the meat of what we're going to do in Module 2, which is core programming. And this will focus a lot on how a computer stores and processes information, what you expect to see in terms of working with some of the different aspects of programming, like decision structures and repetition, and how programming errors creep into your code and how you can work with those successfully and, to basically get your program up and running again. Module 3 takes a look at object-oriented programming, and the thing that's kind of interesting about the way software development has changed over the years, folks now start looking more at trying to model real-world objects in the code that they're writing, and object-oriented programming gives us that ability to do that. So we'll take a look at how we can model those real-world objects, how object-oriented programming plays a very important part in what you'll do as a software developer. Then the next couple of modules, 4, 5, and 6, will give you the opportunity to take a look at examples of some of the types of applications you might be developing. So we'll focus on web applications, take a look at what core, just basic HTML pages look like, and then take a look at what a web application is, how it's hosted on the different platforms. Then we'll give you an example of some of the different desktop applications that you might be focusing on. So even though the web has become relevant over the years, folks spend a lot of time on the internet now, there are still applications written for laptops and desktop computers, so it's important that you understand what those are and what you might be involved in developing from that perspective. Also in Module 6, we'll take a look at databases, because I would say about 99% of your applications today focus on data, and you have to access that data somewhere. Most of the time it's in a database, so we'll talk about databases. We'll give you a demo of SQL Server, show you how you can extract some data, insert and update information in a database, talk briefly about how programmers will connect to it, and then finally we'll finish off with a quick little discussion on, after you've basically seen everything in this session, is this for me? Do I want to pursue software development as a career? Is this something that interests me? And it doesn't always have to be a career. Maybe you're just looking at it from a hobby perspective, and that's perfectly fine as well. But we'll present some resources for you at the end, show you some links to some training, certifications, and how you can ramp up on some more core fundamentals. Obviously, we want to do a little bit of expectation setting up front. We want to let you know what we expect you to have in terms of a mindset and maybe a skill set before you step through this. Software development is not always an easy process. Some of the concepts that you'll learn, or as you go through learning new programming languages, may be a little different than what you're used to, so there's some things that you might want to be aware of. We've listed two bullet points here for target audience. And first of all, A, it's a desire to get started in software development. Otherwise, you wouldn't be here. So that's kind of important, you know, that this is what you want to do, or maybe it's something you think you want to do. So you should have that in mind. You should also be a little bit technically savvy, and this is kind of an ambiguous bullet point. What does technically savvy mean? Does that mean I need to have an engineering degree? Do I need to understand at the deepest level how a computer functions internally? No, that's not what we're saying. But you should be able to understand technology. You should be able to know how to turn on a computer, execute programs, you know, start them up and find your way around file systems and things like that. That's kind of what we're talking about. We do list some suggested prerequisites, and the first one is kind of logical thinkers. That's a little bit of an interesting bullet point as well, because what is a person who thinks logically? And as Paul and I were discussing this the other day, I kind of brought up a little bit of a scenario for him in thinking about most people have a typical morning routine. So you get up in the morning, you know, the alarm clock goes off, you turn it off, hop in the shower, you get dressed, you get out and you have breakfast perhaps, you hop on a bus or in your car and you head off to work. And for most people, that's it. We're happy with that, and that's all we need to worry about. But as a software developer or a computer programmer, you need to dig a little deeper into the concepts of that. So logically thinking, you're going to have to start breaking that down into discrete steps. The alarm clock goes off in the morning. Well, there's a decision to be made. Obviously, you're going to turn it off because it's annoying, but the decision is, do I pay attention to it and get out of bed and go to work, or do I play hooky today and I'm just going to stay off, you know, and stay home sick and not go to work today? So, you know, you start getting deeper into these decisions. When you're, I'm going to take a shower as my next step. Well, there's some logical thinking from that. Is the shower available? If it's not, what am I going to do next? That's the kind of thing that we're referring to when we say logical thinking. You have to start breaking things that you take for granted down into discrete steps and thinking about them from a different perspective. It would be nice if you do have some experience with scripting or beginner programming tasks, although it's not technically necessary here, because we're going to be showing you some code for the samples. And the code that we're going to show you may be foreign to you if you've never seen a programming language before. So if you've got a little bit of that experience, then some of the concepts might be a little bit easier to see from that coding perspective. The ability to understand patterns. Programming deals a lot with patterns in the code itself. We'll talk about how repetition structures create patterns as we repeat and iterate through different loops. We can also talk about how patterns are present in things such as numbering systems and the different sets and the different aspects of the code that you'll deal with. It'll become more apparent when we start focusing on things like our data structures, when we look at arrays and queues and lists and stacks and things like that. You'll need to have the ability to see how patterns are present in these things and work with them specifically. And then finally, a grasp of mathematical concepts. Now, you don't have to be a mathematician. You don't need to have gone through university and gotten a degree in mathematics, certainly. But understanding some of the general concepts, such as what is a set, in programming we deal a lot with sets, which are specific values of numbers, text characters, what have you. And you should also understand numbering systems, because when we start dealing with the data types that a computer stores and how it stores them through the binary concepts, you'll need to understand the different numbering systems that we have and how you work with those specifically in the programming language you're choosing. Because a computer can't store infinite amounts of information, our number systems in computers are limited to certain values. So an understanding of that really helps as you start working through your programming career. Now, obviously, you're here on the Microsoft Virtual Academy. If you haven't already joined the MVA community, you should sign up. You should register for this. It's a great opportunity to get some free online training targeted at developers and IT professionals. We've got over 1 million registered users on the system already. It's a very popular platform. Got some great training on here. Take a look at it. We're always updating the content on here so that we become relevant to what it is that you're looking for. If you see something that's not on there, hey, use the contact information on the website and suggest some topics. We're more than happy to add them. So again, welcome to the MVA community. And let's go ahead and take a look at our first module. So we're going to focus on general software development here. And again, as I mentioned from the intro, general software development will focus on a couple of key aspects that are not specifically related directly to coding. So you're not going to be writing code, or we're not going to be presenting code in this one. But it's more around the processes that you can expect to encounter as you start working as a software developer. These can be as an individual developer, or they can be as you're working in a larger shop, such as, you know, here at Microsoft as a software developer as well. So we'll take a look at the application lifecycle management, and we'll also take a look at how to interpret application specifications. So first of all, in application lifecycle management, again, this is something that is not specific to coding, but it is a process that we use in the industry to help us understand how software is created and how we go through the implementation, designing, testing it, deploying, and managing it. So what you typically find in the industry is a diagram that looks similar to this. Now we have five discrete boxes on here: requirements, design, development, test, and maintain. And this is what you'll typically find listed as an application lifecycle management. Some people call it a software development lifecycle. We could even call this a product lifecycle management. It's not specific to software development, because what it does is it focuses on, again, it's a process. It's a key process that helps us get to where we need to be from our software development lifecycle. We take a look at the box on the top is requirements, and typically this is considered to be the first step in this whole iterative process. Realistically, there's actually one box that we don't see here that we could have added, which is one called envision. So typically before we decide we're going to create a new product or a new software application, somebody has to have a need for it. And this might be a business, a company, it might even be yourself. If you're going to be